good afternoon, and welcome to Sociology 101, The Individual in Society. I am Dr. Squires, and today we're going to continue or actually begin our discussion about religion. Think of where we've come. We've started off with culture. We've talked about how we stratified ourselves. We spent a little bit of time talking about how we come to identify ourselves in terms of race, in terms of sexuality. And so today we're going to talk about religion. What is the role of religion? How does religion function in contemporary society? And when we begin, let's think exactly about what religion is. And I want you to call in if you have a unique religion or a different religion, and let's kind of get a little dialogue going and talk about it a little bit. We will see some interesting religions today, so I want to warn you in advance that some of the stuff may be a little bit graphic, but it's National Geographic's kind of graphic. All right, so religion, the definition, any set of coherent answers to the dilemmas of human existence that make the world meaningful for people. This is a system of beliefs and rituals that helps bind people together. When sociologists study religion, we also often study what is called religiosity. And this is the person's degree of religious feelings. How religious are you? How much do you actually hold on to the tenets of your particular religion? Religion is very different than a church. And so people don't realize you can actually have religion without having a church. And a church is an institutionalized organization of people who share common religious beliefs. So you can have a religion. I have relatives in my family in the Caribbean who practice a particular religion that does not have a church. They believe in following what Jesus did with the disciples, so they would not build a building to worship in. They worship at different people's houses. So once you start to get a church, some kind of structure, this is really different from having just a simple religious belief. And think about what the role of the church is in contemporary society. When you talk about religion, it's important to start off talking a little bit about the sociology of religion, because the sociology of religion does not get into those debates about God versus science. Is people's faith correct? Do people have right belief systems? The sociology of religion studies how religion functions in contemporary society, how people experience their beliefs, and how they turn those beliefs into their everyday lives. The sociology of religion looks at the role of faith in people's lives. We'll see two people later on in this lecture both do the same thing. It kills one group of people, but it doesn't kill one group of people. And so sociologists would look at the power of people's belief systems to influence how life works for them or how things go. And when we talk about the sociology of religion, we look at faith, and what faith is a belief anchored in a conviction rather than in scientific evidence. And so in essence, you can't prove your faith. You take your faith at, in essence, face value. You can't prove that the Ten Commandments were ever written. You just assume and you believe that they were as part of your faith. And so sociology doesn't get into these debates. We'll talk about it because in the society, these ideas of religion versus science are very, very important, and they're becoming more and more important as our science begins to become more and more able to create life or answer some fundamental questions or alter the human condition in some way. And so when we talk about religion, just to go through briefly a little bit of the history, We don't know what the cavemen practiced. Anthropologists and sociologists and historians have speculated that there were some rituals practiced by these early humans. We find evidence of flowers put on the graves. We find evidence of people being buried in particular uniform positions, or people being buried with certain trinkets or symbols, all indicate to us that there was some type of religion. And we assume that it was some early form of animism, the belief that there was a spirit or some kind of energy. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But we don't know, but we do assume, we actually have found rituals around Neanderthal that suggest that they might have had burial rituals, and these burial rituals might have related to a belief in spirits or the afterlife or whatever, and also the idea of burying people with things they might need in the future. And so we found a lot of artifacts that people use in their everyday that would be useful in the future, giving us some idea that people had a belief about the future or some other place maybe the body goes. Early religion, we believe there were no full-time leaders, there were no churches, and it's really difficult because think about it, beliefs don't preserve like fossils. And so unless we find written texts or things that are easily deciphered, we really don't know what the early religions look like. As we move into our era and we get into industrialized society, religion begins to kind of come into a little bit of competition with science in terms of explaining the world. Instead of a deity doing it, we now know that germs make us sick, or we now know that there's a disease that is causing the body to do something. And so as we become more industrial, as we become more technologically advanced, we actually become more scientific, and this kind of has a little bit of competition with religion. Oftentimes people say religion and science are in conflict with each other, but we'll talk about that in a minute. All right, before we get into it, let's get some definitions out. When we talk about religion, we're talking about theism. And in this particular society, theism is the belief that there is a god or a god, gods outside of the humans that influence our behavior, that guide our behavior, that somehow work miracles or magic in our lives. And so when we think about theism, we think about all of the different types of gods that we can have. And we don't know if the cavemen actually had more than one god. We kind of assume that they did. And there are different kinds of theism. In many traditional societies, we talk about a polytheistic society. And this is a society that believes in more than one god. And when you have traditional Greek and Roman society, you have Zeus, you have Athena, you have the god of war, the god of love, the god of fire, etc., etc. All of these gods were the gods you prayed to when you wanted that thing. So if you wanted to win at war, you prayed to the god Zeus. As opposed to this belief in multiple gods, and there are a lot of faiths today that also hold on to the belief that there are multiple deities, not just one. But Christians today and many modern faiths are actually monotheistic. And what this means is that they believe that there is only one God. And my research on this has found that the Egyptian pharaoh Akhenaten is credited with being one of the early proponents of the one God idea. And he wanted everyone to worship the cult of the sun and the sun god. And what is interesting is if you kind of investigate a little bit of history on him, a lot of his face is actually chiseled out of the monuments. And there is an assumption that the people at the the time were very angry because these people were polytheistic. They believed in more than one God. And here was Akhenaten coming and saying, we need to get rid of all these other gods, all these other images, and worship just this one. And so even at the base, when we talk about religion, we can start off with very different perspectives. All right, I want to shift to talk a little bit about different forms of religion. And the first form of religion is animism. And animism is a belief in which there is this idea that everything in the world has a life force. Everything in the world has an element. And I usually show a clip in my class, but it's really old, so it's not good TV quality. But it actually talks about the Native American belief that everything, the trees, the forest, the rocks, the animals, the water, the mountains, has a spirit. If you go to Hawaii, you can often hear of this idea that Pele has a spirit. She's the volcano spirit, and she's the spirit of all of that land. The interesting thing about Pele is that there is actually a post office in Hawaii for people to mail back rocks and things that they take from the mountain. Because one of the beliefs is that Pele does not like for you to take things from her mountain. Don't take volcanic stones, don't take anything. And so oftentimes if you take it, and this is what the belief system says, you will have bad luck. And I was actually watching Ripley's Believe It or Not, or one of those shows, and there was actually a man who took like 3 stones. His friends told him not to take the stones. On the way down the mountain, he broke his leg. His flight was delayed. He got home. He broke his back. His wife left him. And everybody kept saying, it's those stones that you took from the mountain. And he's like, these are stupid. He threw them out the window. And after days and days and days of bad luck, eventually he finds himself crawling around in the backyard looking for these stones. He finds them, he puts them in an envelope, and he mails them back to the mountain. So this is this idea that there is a spirit, a energy, and a life force. For many groups, when you say grace, when you're about to eat dinner, you actually say, thank you for the life force that was given so you can eat. And so this is an idea that that deer had to die, or that tomato or carrot or whatever, so that I could live. And so this is one form. And think about it. What if everything did have an energy? So all the plants, the animals, everything you encountered had a spirit. And that spirit was alive, an essence, a thing. All right, let's move on to the next one. The next idea is this idea of shamanism. And this also has this belief in spirits, but this is ancestral spirits. And shamans believe in channeling. Shamans believe that right now around all of us are our grandparents and great-grandparents, and you can channel the energy from that realm, whatever that dimension is, into this dimension. People who believe in this believe that the ancestors, even though they're gone, the spirits, even though they're gone, they still move in your life. They still have a force in your life. And so these people can kind of channel that force, like Sylvia Brown, John Edwards, all those people we see on modern television are in essence almost modern day shaman. And one of the interesting things about shaman is that we are now, as scientists, going back to try to find information that was lost. Because what we find is that a lot of shamans not only have a good insight into human behavior, human nature, but they also know a lot about the natural environment. So let's take a look at our first clip and then come back and talk a little bit more about shamanism.
Somewhere in this forest, maybe in this plant, or that herb, there might be a cure for diabetes, or malaria, or even your weekly migraine. And as this plant disappears, that cure disappears along with it. The rainforests of Paraguay have long been the source of many medicinal cures. Traditional folk healers often lead the way to the plants that provide them. It's a quest to find one of Paraguay's famed healers, a shaman whose knowledge of medicinal plants equals that of a medical library. Paraguay has one of the highest deforestation rates in the world, and there's a hope to record the shaman's knowledge before the forest disappears. The journey begins in Paraguay's isolated Baracayu Forest Nature Reserve and the adjacent indigenous community Tecoja Reyapu, where shaman Carvesio lives. The search through the forest crosses much of the approximately 150,000-acre reserve. At the village, Carvesio is consumed in his chants and prayers, perhaps to establish a spiritual connection with the forest. When he feels ready, Carvesio and his medicine woman wife lead the group on the search. Carvesio is looking for an elusive root, sometimes called suruvi, also known as Jadrofe Isabeli, and used for various ailments. Scientists are very interested in this family of plants for cancer research. Carvesio brings the root back to the village, where his wife prepares it into a tea. Scientists published a book with help from Carvesio's forest knowledge. The book helps plants in the area to be easily identified and studied. Recording and analyzing Paraguayan plants for possible medical cures is urgent business. Trees and medicinal plants that were once thriving are disappearing, and with them, the possibility to search for new medical cures.
When you think about all of the stuff, I mentioned this some time ago, that we've lost from traditional people, traditional cultures. Well, the shamans, sometimes called witch doctors, in some places channelers, etc. A lot of this knowledge is, how did we use the natural world? Plants, animals, etc. So now we're having to go back and try to capture this knowledge before all of these people are gone. Another form of religion that's kind of related to these other two is this idea of totemism. And totemism is the actual worship of plants and animals. The animist and the shaman don't necessarily worship the plants and animals. They see them as sacred, but for the totem, the plants and animals are the actual deity that is worshipped. A really good book that talks about this is Colin Turnbull's book, The Forest People. And in this book, he talks about the pygmies, and he talks about the pygmies' belief that the forest is their god. In essence, the forest is their life giver. The forest is what helps them to sustain themselves, what helps them to go on in the future. It has been there in the past. So for this group, the forest itself is worship, and the forest itself is sacred. And so these are some early types of religion that many people still actually practice today, even though some of them have taken on some other popular forms. All right, moving on a little bit. Max Weber said, you can tell a lot about the society by kind of looking at the different cultures and stuff like that. Before we begin, though, I was almost about to skip over a clip. I want to show this one clip because I want you to start thinking about what you believe. And so let's take a look at our second clip. And this is a shaman levitating. And you can tell me if you think this is real or some kind of TV magic. So let's take a look at clip number two.
There are other paranormal phenomena which are even documented in the Bible, which defy the forces of gravity. This man, whose name is Ovaku, is an African shaman. And here we can see him preparing himself for a levitation. This will take place as soon as darkness begins to fall. The images which this film has recorded are scarcely to be credited. There are no hidden supports or pulleys to be seen. In spite of this, Ovaku actually rises off the ground and it seems as though he is floating on a cushion of air. The German commentator cannot believe his eyes. There is no question that this is a trick or an illusion, and he's absolutely convinced that he's witnessing a miraculous event, and that the film is incontrovertible proof that levitation is indeed possible. A second cameraman can now be seen hurrying to the side so that he can get closer pictures of the fascinating event. Could it be that there are in fact invisible fields of force which this shaman is able to take advantage of? The shaman's breathing has become unusually fast, and his face is contorted with the effort of the undertaking. Could the technique which we are witnessing here be the very same technique which is said to be practiced in India and in Tibet?
All right, now, do you believe? I don't know. There's a lot of things out on YouTube, but no strings in the middle of the African wilderness. I don't know. You can kind of watch that clip for yourself. It's on the PowerPoint. When we talk about belief, it's really interesting because what you believe also determines what you see. And so I started to talk about what Max Weber said about religion. He said, you can tell a lot about the society by looking at the religion. And in this particular culture, he looked at this idea of Protestantism and the spirit of capitalism. And he said the two kind of work together, this idea of hard work in this life, you'll be rewarded in the future. And so he said if you were to look at the different religions, if you were to look at Christianity, you would be able to see a slightly individualized type of society because that's the type of religion it is. You could extend this to say if you were to look at Islam, you would look and see certain rules and tenets. If you were to look at Confucianism, you would see society based on some principles of behavior. The same thing for Hinduism, and also if you look at Buddhism, you'll see society based on balance. And so some of the major tenets of the religion are reflected in how people organize and structure that society. And so Weber said religion is really, really important if you want to understand what a society is actually like and how the people in that society put their belief systems together. When we talk about religions, there are a lot of different religions. Let's take a look at the other image. When we look at worldwide, Christians, and this was in 1995, we could put it up full screen, Christians are about 37.7%. A good portion of this is Roman Catholics, 16.9%. As we go down to some of the major ones, Jews, 0.2%, Muslims, 19.2%, and we go all the way down. And when we think about the total population, about 66% of the world is non-Christian. And even though Christianity is one of the largest religions, it's actually not the only one. And what is interesting is that people practice their religious faith very, very differently. And so when you look at other religions or people who have other different belief systems, what we can see is your belief is going to determine your ritual and your behavior. I want us to take a look at clip 3, and clip 3 has a couple of different things on it. One, the first one is a very short story of a man who practices Jains, and I believe I'm saying it right. And in this particular religion, you actually have to sacrifice part of yourself in order to show your faith to the deity. And so in order to do that, this man has been standing for 7 years on one foot. And also part of this clip is a little bit of information on a Christian group that practices crucifixion. And I kind of want to set that one up because it is a little bit bloody. So, but like I said, it's National Geographic. So let's take a look at clip 3, and then we'll come back and talk about the different types of religion.
As we've seen, the desire to be closer to one's God can sometimes drive people beyond the realms of what is thought humanly possible and into the world of the unimaginable. Now, witness one individual whose thirst for nirvana personifies mind over matter. Lotan Baba, an Indian mystic, gave up all worldly possessions for a life of spiritual discipline. He vowed to remain standing on one leg for 7 years, changing positions only to eat his meals, which were grass. Having completed his 7-year vow, he took on a new one, to roll across India. A total of 2,500 miles. But don't think for a minute that this is an Asian phenomenon. Even in America, worshippers seek religious ecstasy through their own extreme means. Kingston, Georgia. Thousands in America believe that handling deadly poisonous snakes will bring them closer to God.
You know, I've been snake bit hurt, and I've been snake bit not hurt, so always left in hands of the Lord.
In services that often last 3.5 hours, those who feel it caress the deadly serpents, usually rattlesnakes and copperheads. They claim their ritual springs from a single verse of the Bible.
The reason I handle poison snakes is because the 16th chapter of St. Mark said they shall take up serpents.
San Pedro Cutud in the Philippines. Here, Roman Catholics take their devotion to the Word of the Bible to the greatest extreme. Each year on Good Friday, hundreds of worshipers prepare for Easter, not just by prayer and abstinence, but by reenacting Christ's passion, suffering, and crucifixion.
Every Good Friday in the Philippines, there's this beautiful tradition which we call the crucifixion. And in imitation of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ on the cross, some few volunteers in the Philippines, mostly men, will volunteer themselves to be crucified on the cross.
We all do it for different reasons. We all have personal petitions and intentions we bring along with us to the cross. This is how we choose to honor our Lord. But it's not for everyone.
Like Jesus, participants follow the stations of the cross. As the crowd torments them, they continue their journey until they reach the place where they, like Jesus, will be crucified.
Those who volunteer themselves, they believe that by being crucified on the cross, their sins will be forgiven.
When you can't take the pain anymore, you send the people below a signal and they bring you down. They douse your wounds in alcohol and tie your hands with bandages and send you home. Most of the people say their wounds heal quickly. The longest I've ever lasted on the cross is 7 minutes.
There's a lot of poverty, pains, suffering in the Philippines. They can relate to the suffering Christ.
Okay, we just saw just three snippets, and I'm going to come back to the one in the middle. We're going to talk about the snake handlers at length on Wednesday. But here we have this man whose belief system is that I have to sacrifice comfort, luxury. And can you imagine if your faith dictated you standing on one leg and eating grass for 7 years? And then going all the way to the other group. In the Philippines, this group, they're Christians. They hold the same beliefs as standard Christians. However, they take the ritual to the next extreme. What is interesting about it is that the church actually frowns on this ritual. The church proper, and meaning the Pope, actually does not like this idea of people going around crucifying themselves. So this group practices it, even though the big church doesn't necessarily like it. When we talk about the world, we see multiple religions. When we talk about the United States, we see that this is predominantly a Christian country. And so when we look at how religion is spread over the U.S., it's very interesting because we see concentrations of different religions. In the South, we see Baptists. In the Northeast and Southwest, we see a lot of Catholics. In the Northeast, think of where the Kennedys are from. In the Southwest, we have a lot of Spanish that come in that are actually Catholic. In the middle of the country, what we see on the map is a lot of gray, and that is the Mormons, the Latter-day Saints. And then when we look at this map again, we also see that in the country there are little pockets of black, if you put this one up full screen. And this particular map, these little pockets of black are non-traditional religions, Native American religions. And what we can see is this grouping of the different faiths in terms of where they are isolated in the country. But by far, this is a Christian country. And if you were to go to each of those different churches, you would realize that although they're Christian, they all have very, very, very different belief systems. Mormons are very different from Catholics, and they are very different from Baptists. The rituals are different, etc. So religion is something that in all the societies, even though people may share the same title, they may practice the faith just a little bit differently. Moving on a little bit, Emile Durkheim talks about religion, and he basically said religion unifies society. It is a system of beliefs and practices relative to sacred things. And Durkheim said that there are three elements to all religions. One, a system of beliefs. This may involve your creation story, how we got race, how we got gender, whatever this belief system is. He said the next thing is some kind of social organization or structure. Even though every religion doesn't have a church, there's rules and expectations of the members of a religion. And so every group has a particular structure that people learn. Then he said another element of religion is sacred things. These are things that are very different from what we would call profane objects. Sacred things are things that are set aside. They're things that are special to us. And when we talk about sacred things, like when we see this cross, this is a simple wooden cross. However, it doesn't matter if this cross is made out of twigs, if it's made out of scrap wood. Once it's formulated into this symbol, it becomes sacred. And I bought an example of something that was given to me, and this is a sacred object. I'm not going to do it, but what would happen if I were to just simply turn this upside down? What would that symbolize in terms of religion? And for a lot of people, they would become angry. I'm sure the phones would light up, because that would be the Antichrist, symbolizing anti-religion. The interesting thing about the wooden cross, and not this glass one, is that many churches, particularly Catholic churches, all have supposedly a little sliver or a little piece of this cross. And it's estimated that you could actually build a house if you were to put all these little pieces of wood together. Are they part of the true cross? Not really. Probably, but are they really sacred and important to the people who practice that belief? Absolutely. So Durkheim said, religion is an essential unifying force. From the symbolisms, then we talk about the rituals. And when we think about these rituals kind of, in essence, bond us together a little bit. And so Durkheim talks about the functions of religion as well. And he says basically there's a couple of different functions. And one of the first functions is for social integration. So religion functions for social integration. Religion kinds of, it brings us all together. It brings a society. We know that we're a Christian society as opposed to this society that is a Muslim society. We have, in essence, a collective belief system of where we came from. And so one of the functions of religion is that it brings people to society. Brings people together. And we're on 19 now. One of the other functions of religion, besides social integration, is collective identity. Religion brings you into the group. When you go through a bar mitzvah, or one of those type of rituals, or a confirmation, you actually are being welcomed into that body of faith. So after a young boy goes to a bar mitzvah, after his bar mitzvah, they say, you're no longer a boy, you're actually a man, and you are now welcome into the faith. For some groups, without going through certain rituals, you can't take communion, you can't fully participate because you don't have that identity yet. Religion also functions for social control. And a good example of this is actually the Pope, because from the Vatican, the Pope dictates the norms and values of the followers of that religion. So one of the norms is, and one of the values is on life. And so one of the norms and one of the expectations for people who follow the Pope is that you cannot use birth control. And so for many followers of that faith, that's actually a sin that they break on a regular basis, because every time they have sex, they don't want to reproduce. And so this is one element that is often difficult for people to adhere to. But religion sets up the norms and values, and if you adhere to them, you are supposed to follow them word for word. Another thing that religion does is it answers the unanswerable questions. Why do kids die? Why do bad things happen to good people? Why does the sun come up? Well, religion helps us answer these things. This is God's will. This is God's way. We can't come up with any other answer. It must be the way of the universe, etc. Religion provides for us another important rite, and this is a rite of passage. The bar mitzvah is not just bringing someone into an identity, but it's taking them from one place to another. A good example of this is the quinceañera. When a girl goes through a quinceañera at 15, what she's actually saying before her family and before God is that, I am going to be chaste, I am going to be pure. And after the quinceañera, she starts off as a little girl, then she receives her first set of adult shoes. and has her first adult dance with her father. And this is her passage into womanhood. She's saying, I'm going to be pure, I'm going to be chaste until it's time for me to be a good wife and get married. So this is a really important element of religion. Another element of religion is that it reconciles people to hardship. Think about many of the religious songs, many of the religious hymns, many of the gospel songs say, we will suffer in this life, but we shall overcome in the future. There is a promised land waiting for us somewhere. And so the interesting thing is that, think about it, it gives you comfort. I know that I'm struggling and I'm suffering right now, but in the end, I'm going to be okay. And so this is a really important element to religion, because this is how people survive Hurricane Katrina, disasters, and all of those kind of things. Religion also promotes social change. And this is interesting because a lot of people don't know that Christianity started off as a cult. Christianity started off as a group of Jews that had a slightly different belief system. And the belief system was that Jesus was the promised Messiah. This Messiah had returned. So one basic difference between Christianity and Judaism is that Christians believe the Messiah has returned, and Jews believe that the Messiah hasn't come yet. They're not anti-Jesus. They just don't see Jesus as the Messiah that was expected. And so think about it. This small group of Jews ended up being now one of the world's major religions, but it started off as a break-off, as an offshoot. Jesus was Jewish, and he was practicing just slightly, a little bit different traditions than traditional Judaism. So these are some of the functions of religion. And I want us to think about some of the functions of some religious rituals, and particularly an exorcism. What is the function of an exorcism? And the interesting thing is that a lot of people don't realize that exorcism is part of the Christian doctrine. Periodically, and on the website you'll be able to read it, but the Pope put out a doctrine that says exorcism is okay, but only registered, certain ordained priests are able to do it in the society. So think about what exorcism does. If this is a person that is acting deviantly, well, exorcism is going to bring them back, get them back to normal, get them back into the norms and values. So let's take a look at an exorcism, and then we'll come back and talk about a little bit more about the functions of religion.
You don't have to be a priest to be an exorcist. It is believed that anyone who is imbued with the power of the Holy Spirit has the ability to perform exorcisms.
Many are called, but few are chosen. Everyone can, not all will.
The Reverend Bob Larson is an evangelical minister who has dedicated his life to developing his skills as an exorcist.
Well, I've been involved in deliverance and exorcism for more than 30 years. When I started, there was very little knowledge. I was flying by the seat of my pants. The Bible gives us scant information about how to do it. It simply says to cast out demons. You just go do it and you figure it out. The best way to get the job done.
Reverend Larson is one of the most prolific exorcists in North America, spending months on the road every year to exorcise demons from the bodies of man and return them to hell.
I set out with a goal, and that was to make sure that no one in America would be more than a day's drive from a city where they could find an exorcism. And now we have more than 100 teams in America and Canada, and many more all around the world. And these people have learned to do what I've learned to do.
Reverend Larson believes that satanic affliction is more common than one might think.
I never have to go looking for demons. Never have. They always find me.
This is God's place, God's property, God's people. You have no right to be here.
Reverend Larson has traveled to this small ministry in Phoenix, Arizona to help those in need.
A few people have demons and know they have demons. Most don't have a clue. They think they have a problem. And it's usually compulsive, highly addictive, something, they've gone to counseling, they've gone to therapy, they've gone to priests, pastors, they've prayed, they've taught, they've tried everything, and they just can't get past it. I tell people, if you've tried everything, and it hasn't worked, who are you going to call? Try the exorcist.
That which is caused by anxiety can be relieved by reassurance. And many of these things are examples of anxieties that these people have because they've adopted it as part of the fear of the unknown, the fear of the evil that they perceive in the world. And it's generally whipped up in subtle or not so subtle ways by those around them.
After a brief service, Larson begins to meet with those who may be possessed.
In the name of Jesus. What are you sitting down for, Marty?
No.
I anoint you with oil in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Look at me, Marty. It stands under judgment now. I put it under judgment. Judgment.
Within moments, Reverend Larson is speaking not with a person, but with a demon.
Who did we miss? Ah! Well, you face the judgment. You face the judgment. Who did we miss, sir?
Exorcism is the act of expelling a demon. First of all, it's identifying the demon, provoking it.
Spirit of abominations, I take authority over you. Oh, spit on me. Why are you there, abominations? Why are you there?
Come on, lay hands on me. Some people are in a lot of pain. They physically struggle. The demons attack them internally in their bodies. We go in to take back the prisoners that he has claimed. It says in Hebrews 4:12 that the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. I just go like that and literally use it as a spiritual weapon.
You say it, abomination.
By forcing the demon to name itself, Larson can reveal the sin that allowed it to enter this man's body.
Desecrated the Torah.
An ancestor desecrated the Torah?
Fine. Because he worshiped false idols before the God of Israel.
I tell the demon what to say. And in doing so, he renounces his right to the person and declares that he is going to leave for the pit or the abyss. And the demons may say, if you tell me to leave, I'll kill you. You have to get them past the fear and the intimidation. That's the real battle.
Look at the Lord. Do you trust and believe that word?
I trust and believe the word.
I renounce that sin.
I renounce it.
The sin of idolatry.
The sin of idolatry.
All of these sins.
All of these sins.
Are renounced.
Are renounced.
There is one God.
There is one God.
When a demon goes, you know that it goes. Because the battle is so arduous and intensive. It's not for the faint of heart.
Help me start. I'm helping sit down there. Can I check that air again?
There was something there when I was moving around and shaking.
Now think about what we just saw. This is a group of people coming together to help Marty, to get him back to normal. And when we think about this idea of an exorcism, don't think this is something going on in the backwoods, because in the time, in the hour that we've had this class, there are probably exorcisms going on all over California right now. And let's go back to the discussion we had about deviance. And I said one of the explanations for why people act out in society is demonic possession. The devil made me do it. I have something bad in me. And so for this particular belief system, think about what exorcism does. Exorcism not only helps that one person, but it actually brings that person back into the social norms. And so when we start talking about religion, we're getting towards the end of the semester. So we want to start grouping and tying everything together. Think about it. This idea of religion sets up for us what is normal and what is deviant, what is expected and what is seen as outside of standard operating behavior. If you look in that clip, if you get to watch it again, there are kids in that room. And so those kids are being socialized into the belief system that if I am having problems, if I may not do well in school, if I may be having bad thoughts, then not only is it the possibility that there may be something physically wrong with me, but there's also the possibility that there may be something spiritually wrong with me. And so the kids are being socialized into that belief, and those kids would more likely than other kids seek exorcism if they are having some kind of social trouble. One of the most famous cases of exorcism is, of course, The Exorcist. And this was a case actually of a little boy and not a little girl. And what is interesting is that he's still alive right now and he's an adult. And he has kind of, he doesn't want any publicity. He doesn't want anybody to know who he is. He kind of wants to go on and live a normal life. But the priests who were connected to that, and some are still around, believe that they saw this young man possessed. They believe that they saw him elevate from the bed, that all the things in the movie, which of course were exaggerated, but they believe all these things to be real and still hold on to that belief system today. And so religion begins to kind of show us a lot about what our culture expects from different people. So we have all of these functions of religion. Let's go back. Bring people together. We have religion giving people a collective identity. We have religion answering all of these unanswerable questions for us, telling us when we have gone from childhood to adulthood, or regular people into the body of the group of those people. And so there's a lot good about religion. But I want to now get to what other functionalists have found about religion. And we'll just kind of start off this. We won't get to really go into too much detail. But religion very much can be dysfunctional for society. And we can even go back and look at exorcism. In the last 10 years, there have actually been a rise in exorcism. And there's actually also been a rise in a couple of deaths related to exorcism. Because there was one case in particular of a young lady who was, she was hearing things, she was acting out, she was angry, was a lot going on with her behavior, and her family and the church decided that she needed an exorcism. And she was fighting and flailing, and these were adults that were on top of her trying to exorcise the spirit. Well, what they didn't realize was they covered her with blankets, sat on her, held her down, trying to get the demons out, and they actually suffocated the young lady. And so when we talk about religion, there's a lot that can go wrong in how people practice their particular beliefs. And to talk about the relationship between beliefs and faith, and this is interesting for sociologists because science is actually proving that this old adage that faith can move mountains has some validity. Apparently prayer does work, and etc. And there is one particular case of this gentleman who believed that he was possessed. And I don't show this clip, it's really long, but he went to the hospital, he believed he was in New Orleans, he believed he was possessed, and the reason he believed he was possessed and he was going to die is because earlier he had gone to see a witch doctor or a roots woman, and he refused to pay this woman, and so she put a curse on him. And so this old gentleman shows up at the hospital. He is, for all intents and purposes, dying. He's telling people he's dying. The doctors are hooking him up. They can't find anything wrong with him. And one of the doctors happens to be from New Orleans. And this doctor grew up around voodoo, ancient traditions, natural traditions that the African descendants practiced in New Orleans. And so what he did was he actually did an exorcism in the hospital on this gentleman. And he took some of his hair, he took a medical chemical that could burn, and he took the gentleman downstairs and he said, if you tell anybody, this won't work. And so he said, we are removing the curse, tomorrow you're going to be fine. Well, the very interesting thing is that the very next day this gentleman was well. And so when we start talking about belief systems, it's very, very interesting because he woke up, he started to eat. The doctor said, how are you doing? He said, I'm doing fine. And he was released out of the hospital. And so what researchers have found is that your belief can influence you to die if you believe that strongly enough. And in many traditions, there's the evil eye and all that kind of stuff. When we come back, I want to talk a little bit about how religion can be dysfunctional. And right now, I have finally finished your exam, and I've been a little bit fluid, giving you a little bit more time to study for the exam, and your exam will become available tonight at midnight. And it's based on your lectures for the class. I may ask, and I do ask, one or two questions regarding some of the clips that we've seen, and also the questions relate to the different lectures. And so I'm going down as fast as I can. I always end by saying, because I try to respond to people as soon as I get an email, but I have 700 and I can't get them down. But when we come back, I want you to start thinking about religion. And one of the options is, how would you design your own religion? What would you worship? Many religions are started by regular people just like us. And trust me, get online, and I want you to look up the Elvis religion. I think there's beginnings of a Clay Aiken religion. There is the Backstreet Boys religion. And so if you get online and if you do some searching, you'll actually find that whatever's going to answer the questions for people, people can turn that into a religion. So keep looking for your grades. Like I said, look for your test tonight at midnight. And if you have any problems, just email me and I will correspond directly to you. See you next week, and we'll continue our talk about religion. Bye-bye.